My name is Jean-Pierre Hubaux. I'm the first of the two speakers. Then there's going to be Erman Ayday, who is going to cover the second half. Welcome to this tutorial that is devoted to privacy and security in the genomic era. So we have a lot of material and we'll provide also pointers. So don't be surprised, we'll have to go relatively quickly on some of the topics. It's a huge area that is still at the very beginning, and we will try to, let's say, convey as much information as possible, but we have to assume, I think, that most of you have little or no background in genomics, and so we'll also have to provide you with the appropriate, let's say, basic information on that topic as well. All right, so the way we are going to cover the thing is that we'll first, I'm going to cover part one, which is the background and the threats. So I'll first start with describing the attacks on and breaches in medical data, then explain why we're moving to the genomic era. We'll see also the different uses of genomic data. It's a relatively complex field. We'll talk about the threats and then talk also about key genomic privacy, and then Erman will talk about the possible solutions. So this is, we are not too numerous, so this can be a fairly, I guess, interactive session, so feel free to raise questions at any point in time, and we'll also leave a bit of time at the end of the global session itself. All right, so there seems to be some latency. Well, so the avalanche of digital medicine is coming. So the world is about to change again because medicine, as you know, is becoming more and more digital. The fact that it is digital means that there's a huge amount of medical data that has to be collected, stored, processed, secured. And this is, of course, a major security and privacy challenge because of the complexity and because of the sensitivity of the data. Oops. So this has been well understood. You know, the MIT Technology Review has had as its front page, we can now engineer the human race based on, this was actually last year. Likewise, the IEEE spectrum was making similar claims, hacking the human OS. So how big data will transform medicine and health. Of course, as soon as engineers put babies on their front pages, there are all reasons to get a bit scared, right? But this is just to show that there is tremendous technological capabilities that are actually becoming available. And as a consequence, we have to anticipate what this is going to mean actually for our own field. Okay, so let me first start with the attacks and against medical databases. This is a fact that is probably known to most of you, but not necessarily to all of you, is that there is actually, unfortunately, now a well-established tradition of attacks against medical data. The most prominent one was revealed a year and a half ago, and was against Anthem. As you know, Anthem is one of the US largest health insurers, and it happened that 60 to 80 million unencrypted records were stolen in that specific hack. And that hack essentially led to a number of personal data being stolen, including social security numbers, birthdays, addresses, email, etc., etc. So very, let's say, intimate information that got essentially stolen. So this is there are many other examples in the U.S. Let me move now to the next. The magnitude of the problem has become such that the US government has set up the so-called US healthcare wall of shame, right? If you go to this website here, this URL, This is a website where the companies or organizations that suffer a breach affecting more than 500 people have to report the breach, right? And so you see here, this is just a small sample of those companies. So one, each row corresponds to a breach, and it describes the nature of the breach, how many people were affected, which institution was affected, and so on. You may wonder why they do it. Well, there is an incentive in the sense that if a company suffers a breach and fails to report it, in spite of the fact that the people on board know it, then the sanctions can be even more severe. So it's a kind of transparency effort that is that essentially underpins this procedure. Now, in Europe, we don't have that level of transparency yet. The mentality is somewhat different, but the new legislation of data protection goes to some extent in that direction, although exposure to public shame is probably not something that is going to happen on this side of the Atlantic. So you might want to go, it's very interesting, you just go to that thing, and you, what you can notice is that there are around two declared breaches per week, and each of them is affecting more than 500 people by definition. But in some cases, it can be, you know, tens of thousands, it can be millions, or even tens of millions of people that are affected, which means that in the case of the US, much of the population essentially is in there, right? This is about America. In Europe, in Germany more specifically, there have been other examples of attacks. Actually, this was earlier this year. These were ransomware attacks against German hospitals. So, wenn Cyberkriminelle ein Krankenhaus lahmlegen, which means essentially when cybercriminals block the functioning of a hospital by, well, the conventional, unfortunately now well-known attack that consists in encrypting, I mean, sending the Trojan horse encrypts the files, and then there is a request for ransom to be paid, otherwise the files don't get decrypted, right? And so if the hospital pays, then the hospital is provided with the key that allows to decrypt the files and move on with the proper operation of the hospital. Of course, ransoms are usually requested in bitcoins. Another example is related to, yeah. So it depends, right? In some cases, In some cases, they pay. In other cases, they don't pay. So I don't know what happened in that specific instance. But what happens is that the police doesn't know exactly what to respond in such cases, because essentially they are unable to decipher those files. And from what I hear is that they say, well, maybe if the amount is not too high, maybe you should pay. And the amounts from what they refer are in the order of tens of thousands of euros, so it's a relatively modest amount. But it's very dangerous, because it essentially is an incentive for this business to flourish. Right? Of course, it's an immense perverse kind of business. Okay, now, even in Switzerland, that happened actually last year, that medical data were put on the web. In this case, there was no attack whatsoever. It was just by mistake that the files of more than 8,000 people were just made available online for several days, including the full patient identifications with full name, birth date, etc., and including HIV and other tests. So this was quite a shock and a scandal in highly peaceful Switzerland. Okay, so the another dimension that I think needs to be taken into account is the fact that there is more and more willingness of many of us to measure ourselves. So the quantified self, right, has boomed over the last years. But then it has taken the attention also of health insurers. And so here the temptation is to say, well, after all, maybe we should equip the people we insure to check their lifestyle, right? And so if they exercise enough, for example, they are going to obtain a discount. Right? And these kind of things exist already in in the US, and we thought, okay, that the US is relatively creepy, that's fine, but it's never going to happen here. And actually, believe it or not, it's happening even in Switzerland. So there are now insurance companies that do such things, which of course has, I think, very dangerous long-term implications. So these are, let's say, examples of what happens on that front. So these are things that are still, in some cases, in pilot phases, but you know, it's about thousands of people that are insured with those companies and that essentially can get tracked. So they are equipped with these devices, they go around, and the insurance company obtains all their data in terms of location, et cetera, and can check that whether indeed this person have done their 10,000 steps per day or whatever. And then the next step, of course, is going to be to monitor also their nutrition, the rate at which they make love. I don't know. So it's going to be, I think, something that can be very precise and somewhat, it's controversial, I think. So now let me move to a short medical riddle. It's more than 100 years old. It is about medical practice, and most of it is still valid and respected today. What is it? Question to the audience. Any idea? Right? Yeah, so how is it called? Yeah, exactly. So it is indeed the Hippocratic Oath, which essentially contains several aspects, including, you know, do not harm, the different issues related to the practice of medicine. And one of the articles, are like 10 or 12 in this pledge, is indeed about the fact that the caregiver is not supposed to reveal anything about the patient. So the Hippocratic Oath itself has evolved since then, right? For example, with respect to abortion, it has to be adapted from that point of view. Medicine has, fortunately for us, completely changed since those times, right? But that very principle has remained unchallenged and unmodified over 23 centuries. Right? So the fact that Facebook exists nowadays does not mean that privacy is dead and that medical confidentiality should be forgotten. So this is something that is really at the core of the trust between the caregiver and the patient. Right? Okay, so let's move now to the genomic era itself. So this is an era that is considered to have started around 13 years ago, when it was actually when a major achievement was completed, which is the sequencing of the human genome, the achievement was that essentially the full genome was a human being was unveiled and made public, right? So the genomic era itself is characterized by the fact that sequencing, so the ability to read the genome, right? The genome is the data that describes the DNA that is in each of our cells, right? So we have billions of cells in our body, and unless something goes wrong, we have exactly the same replica of DNA in each of them, right? And now the ability to read this is something that is fairly recent, but the cost of which is declining faster than something that would evolve like Moore's law, right? And so here you see the evolution from 2001, 2002, 2003, which was in the order of hundreds of millions of dollars to sequence one individual, to something that is nowadays around $1,000, which means it is in the same ballpark as, let's say, the regular medical examination, right? Like an MRI or X-ray, etc. So, which means that it is becoming highly affordable, which also means that everyone in this room, sooner or later, most probably is going to be sequenced. Right? We're all going to go through that process. This, and there are good reasons to do that, because there is tremendous potential that is related to the knowledge of genomic data in terms of early diagnosis and preventive medicine, but also pharmacogenomics, or the ability to fine-tune treatment to specific to the specific profile of patient. So the genomic era essentially opened the door to a personalized medicine. This is also shown in this slide. Voilà. So this shows, let's say, the growth. There's a number of people who have been already sequenced. So we were moving here from, 3 years ago, around 200,000. Nowadays, more than 1 million and a half. So 1 million and a half is still a relatively modest number compared to the 7+ billion people on Earth. But still, it shows the trend, right? So it's really something that is growing extremely fast. This has, of course, been noticed by governments. So the notably, actually, the first who really was assertive on this was David Cameron. So before his political suicide, decided to say, well, the UK should certainly go in that direction, and so said we need to sequence 100,000 citizens. And then the US have followed and said, okay, it's going to be 1 million in our side. And these projects are still ongoing. So ambitious projects involving many institutions, hospitals, and so on. And they have essentially provided a substantial impetus around this topic. And there are also other initiatives of the similar magnitude in other countries that have been announced since then. Now, as a consequence, the IT giants have noticed this phenomenon and are, everyone is there. So Google, IBM, Microsoft, Apple, Amazon have programs or services that are related to this. Google in particular can store your genome for the bargain price of $25 a year. So if you want to provide them with, to entrust them with this kind of data. Now, there are so many people working in this space that an alliance has been created, the GA4GH, the Global Alliance for Genomics and Health, that is aiming at defining common framework for effective, responsible, and secure sharing of genomic data and genomic and clinical data. And they also have a security working group in which we are involved that focuses specifically on how the data should be secured. One thing I like to mention is that there is enormous effort on the side of genomics, and there is now the ability to do so-called genome editing, which means that it is possible to alter a genome, like, you know, edit it like with a text editor, to modify essentially the string, which has, of course, very strong potential for treatment genetic diseases. And this can be applied also for to the human genome. Now, this is extremely powerful, but it means that essentially for the first time on the history of this planet, a species is able to modify its own evolution in a way that is not compliant with what Darwin has described, right? So should we do such a thing or not? Well, this is very scary. It is so scary that actually less than a year ago, a moratorium was pronounced and signed between notably the US, UK, and China to say, okay, we pledge to not modify inheritable traits of the human genome, at least for the moment, because we don't know where this would lead to. Right? Just to show you the potential of the whole things. But this has been used at least once on monkeys, and it seems to work. Okay, so now let's move now to the next slide. If doable. Voilà. So this shows the way the sequencing works. So one starts from the samples. So the samples are essentially the, usually in a medical setting, is blood. The blood is fed into a sequencing machine. So the sequencing machine, actually the blood is mixed with appropriate chemical component that will essentially explode the DNA in small snippets that are called the reads. And so the outcome of this phenomenon is a big file, a computer file, called a FASTQ file, and where you find all these short reads in somewhat scattered with each other, with respect to each other. They need to be aligned, and the result, after alignment, the files resulting from that operation is the SAM or BAM file, which is, you know, the 3 billion letters pairs with a specific coverage, right? And so they look like this. We're not going to go into the details, but essentially there is a header, and then there is essentially a sequence of letters A, C, G, and D, and T that correspond to the different chemical components of the DNA. And then one takes these files, and with an additional transformation, they are converted into VCF files, which is the delta with respect to the reference genome. This is this takes advantage of the fact that human genomes are almost all the same. So here in this room, we share more than 90% of the genome is exactly the same, and this is the reason why we are human beings, right? But there are a few variations, and those variations make us a bit taller, a bit shorter, make us having blue eyes or brown eyes, and to be susceptible or more resistant to specific diseases, and so on. Yes?
Is the
So similarity, so the range, the thing that is the same across the whole genome is around 99.9%. With the chimpanzee, it's 98%. So we are only 2% off the chimpanzee. Which, okay, that's like it. like it or not. For some people, well, and for some others, it's even less, yeah. But 2% on average. Okay, so now this whole chain, so from here on is essentially computers, right? And it has to be appropriately managed and secured, of course. Okay, let's move to the next slide. Voilà. So this is just a little bit of genomics to facilitate the comprehension of the next things. The most common genetic variation is, so which means that a delta with respect to the conventional, let's say to the place where the difference between genomes is a so-called single nucleotide polymorphism, which is pronounced SNPs, a SNP, right? This is where in a given position, there is actually more than 1% that differ in that specific position in the whole string, right? And these nucleotides are called, so the value that they can take, right, A, C, G, or T, are called alleles. The beautiful terminology in genomics, as in the whole medicine, by the way. And these alleles can be either major or minor, because they take usually only two values. Major is the most frequent one, and minor is the less frequent one. And each individual, you have to think of two kind of strings of this kind, so there's actually two letters at each of the positions. And so there are two possibilities for each, so as a result, each of the position can be either homozygous, so-called homozygous major, which means that the two of them are the two most frequent ones, homozygous minor, they are the least frequent ones, and heterozygous is one of each sort. Okay, now, here, for example, in this case, at this position two, the alleles can be either A or T. Major is A, minor is T. So in one individual we see is AT, right? Which means that it is actually heterozygous. And the other one, this individual B, is TT, which means that it is homozygous minor. Right? If we move to the next step,
how did you know it's C and B?
So the locations on the genome are known, right? So the location of the SNPs are known, and they have been known, they've been discovered, let's say, by analysis of enough of high enough number of genomes by saying, okay, most by observation by saying, okay, on this position, every individual observed so far has exactly the same values, but there are positions where this is not the case. Voilà. Next, another example here. Okay, it went a bit too fast. Let me just check. Vielleicht ist die Batterie nicht gut, ja? Another device. Let's try this. Well, now let's move to the long-awaited happy end of the Alice and Bob story, right? We are here at CCS, so we are all familiar with Alice and Bob. And so the story is that after extensively authenticated each other, and after having exchanged thousands of highly private and intimate messages, after years of intense but platonic relationship, finally, what happens is that Alice and Bob got closer to each other, right? So as we know now, a human being can be characterized by these two pairs of strings, right? And so in some, so what happens is that each of them generates, let's say individually, some things that we could call nonces. So these nonces are an extraction of their DNA, right? By taking one part of that, the upper string, then one part from the lower string, and so on and so forth. And so this leads to a gamete, right? So a nonce, if you wish, which in the case of the male individual would be a spermatozoon. And on her side, Alice would do the same thing. Voilà, same stuff. And in that way, she's going to have her own contributions. Voilà. Good, voilà. And then in certain conditions of temperature and pressure, so what would happen is that, because so far this process is, let's say, made offline, if you wish, right? It's an offline process, right? And then they go more online. Oops. They go more online. What happened? So we are jumping back. So okay, here's a suspense, right? Allez. Allez, allez. Là. The long-awaited story. It doesn't work, yeah. So can you click for me, or can we change device? I have my own device. Yeah, sure. Can you click? Or should we change device? Because this device doesn't work. The distance, maybe. Okay. Can you click for me? Yeah? Yeah? Okay, so let's click, because now we want to know, right, what happens with those fellows, right? So please click, 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 click. Okay, click, slowly, voilà, you click, click, click. Now it's delicate, you click again, voilà, and then, voilà, click, bam, voilà. So they get closer to each other, and they combine their nonces. This is the online phase, right, and you click again. Yes, and voilà. Here is Charlie. Okay, very good. So this is just to show that the two, let's say the genome of the resulting kid is going to be a combination of the two parents, which you know, of course, but this is the way it works, and which means that there is high connection between the genomes of the kid and the genomes of the parents, which is the reason why we look alike our parents in most cases. Okay. Click, click. You click? Okay, click. Voilà. Uses of genomic data, please click. Okay, medical use. So the genetic disease risk tests help early diagnosis of serious diseases. So the first application, second application is the pharmacogenomics, which is used for personalized medicine. Click. Voilà. Example, the Angelina Jolie effect. This was in Time magazine a few years ago. So this was essentially based on a genomic test. This actress, famous actress, decided to have her breasts and ovaries removed because the risk of cancer in her case was too high. Right? That's a decision, right? And so the concern of the medical system is to say that more and more people will be willing to make to have some surgery just because of some, let's say, genetic tests. Click. Well, this works? Yeah. Thanks a lot. Okay, great. Thanks a lot, yeah. So other uses of the DNA. So it's very important to keep in mind that what we are talking here is primarily the medical aspect, but there is also the legal and forensic dimension for paternity testing, for example, to determine association with a crime or crime scene. Well, DNA is mentioned again and again, of course, in such stories. Inference of key involved in a crime. Increase the databases. Now, of course, the police on its side is increasing more and more the database it makes use to solve issues. And so that's a very important aspect. Another aspect is direct-to-consumer services. So it's for this, I have two specific slides. One is, the first example is Ancestry.com that already has 1 million customers. More than 1 million customers. So here, this is a website where essentially you're invited to provide a sample of your own saliva. This saliva gets, analyzed, because there is, as you know, DNA also in our saliva. And as a consequence, what this company provides you with is essentially about information about your own ethnicity, right? And you discover that you have ancestors from all over the world, and so some racist people, white supremacists, discovered that they have African ancestry. And they were completely shocked and traumatized, right, of course. We all have African ancestry, right? Okay, so the second example is 23andMe, which is probably even more well-known. So here the purpose is different. Here the main purpose is to provide information in terms of predispositions to specific diseases. And so this is the kind of feedback it provides. So here again, it is based on a sample of saliva that is shipped over by post, right? And so you provide your saliva, and then they open you a web account. And this web account tells you that, for example, for Alzheimer's disease, your risk is 14% to be compared with an average risk of 7%. Bam. Then what you do with that is a personal decision, but at least now you know, right? So there have been several stories because at some point it appeared that outcome was not as accurate as it was proclaimed, and so at some point 23andMe was even asked to not do this kind of test anymore, but they now have fixed the problem apparently, and so it's still back in operation. And so the business model is to let users pay for the test, but also these data are sold to the pharma for the users who accept, who provide consent for that purpose. Okay, now let's move to the third, yeah? Yeah, yeah, of course. No, the data is anonymized. But of course, it is anonymized. But of course, it is a genomic data, which, as we know, is identifying, right? But well, the hope is, of course, that the pharma does not do evil with this. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. So now let me move to the canonical misconception about genome privacy and security. Now, some people say, oh, genome privacy is hopeless because all of us leave biological cells, such as hair, skin, droplets of our saliva, et cetera, wherever we go. And those cells can be collected and used for DNA sequencing. And as a consequence, trying to secure genomes is a lost battle, right? So now, what is wrong with this reasoning? What is wrong? Well, it is wrong because collecting human biological samples and sequencing them is expensive, illegal, prone to mistakes, and non-scalable. Even sequencing techniques keep improving. So it's always better for an attacker to just go for the database where the data are available and are cleanly organized, as opposed to go running around Vienna and collecting pieces of hair on the buses and the subway. Right? So, of course. So that, but that, I think this is a misunderstanding that we have heard again and again and again. Okay. Now, of course, in addition to this, the medical community is absolutely unwilling to be the direct or indirect accomplice of massive leaks of sensitive data. This would be, of course, absolutely detrimental. So why should we protect the genomic data? So the reason is that a genome carries information about a person's genetic condition and participation in specific diseases, and so this can lead to genetic discrimination. So they have access to health insurance, mortgage, education, and employment. How many of you have seen this movie, Gattaca? Please raise your hand proudly. Okay, half of you. So you may, the other half may want to check it. It's really interesting and thought-provoking. Let's move now to the whole landscape of big data, right? So there are the research data sets in genomics. There are also the ancestry data sets. There's the online social networks. There's the health and genome webs, the public records in terms of census records, marriage records, obituaries, et cetera. So it is, there's plenty of data that are available for someone who would be willing to do re-identification attacks, kinship inference, and so on and so forth, right? So the risk is that by interconnecting these websites, it is possible actually to infer quite a number of things. Okay, and so this is one story with genetic testing. I gave my parents the gift of divorce because by looking actually in those data, this fellow, the fellow who is writing this story, discovered that he had a half-brother, and then when interrogating his father, he realized there was an affair in the past, blah, 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 blah. Okay, so you can imagine the kind of things that can happen. Okay, so now as a consequence, there is debate to what extent genomic data should be made available to the researcher or to the public at large, and what kind of precautions have to be taken. Right? And so this is a topic on which there have been a lot of papers written, a lot of discussions organized, and it started with one major example of an attack, which is the so-called Homer attack. Which is the gist of it I'm going to explain on the next slide. It's enough actually to have a few tens of thousands of the SNPs to determine whether an individual is part of a cohort, so a group of patients, or not, right? And so the idea here of the attack, you know, in medicine, what it is customary to separate between a case group and a control group. So the case group is where the people who have a specific ailment are, and the control group is just to make sure that the study makes sense from the statistical point of view, right? And so what these authors have shown is that by the knowledge of the genome, they would be able to know whether a given person who is in the study, whether this person is in the case group or in the control group, right? And this makes a lot of difference because the case group, the fact of being in the case group, might mean that the person has a specific disease, such as, you know, is HIV infected or has cancer or whatever, right? So this is based on relatively simple statistics. I will spare you the details, but essentially by checking the different values of the SNPs of the individual with respect to the values for the reference group and for the case group, it is possible to assess the likelihood to be on one side or on the other. We'll put the slides online, and you can check this, and the paper is also available. It's relatively simple reasoning. I have to accelerate a bit. There is now the G4GH that I mentioned before has set up the Bilkent project. The Bilkent project aims at defining, let's say, putting in a kind of network the certain number of databases to facilitate comparison of available, I mean, to let's say share essentially data that are available in various hospitals, right? And so what the first let's say feature that is provided is that if a researcher wants to know whether a given there are some patients with a given variant at a given location, they should respond, right? So it should say, do you have it? Do you have someone who has, do you have at least one person who had this variant in Beacon 1, so in Hospital 1? Response, no. How about Beacon 2? Yes, we have at least one, and so on, right? Now, very recently, it was actually less than a year ago, exactly 1 year ago, actually, two authors have shown that this can be used in order to, this kind of feature, this kind of interrogation, is enough to carry out specific attacks, the so-called Sringampur and Bustamante attack. The idea is to generate here a certain number of queries, and based on the response to these queries, to infer, right, whether a given, to infer the identity of a given individual. Right? And this attack can be actually extremely dangerous, of course, if and detrimental if the beacon is associated with a sensitive phenotype, such as, for example, a cancer. Right? So here are the details. I'm unfortunately, I'll have to skip them. But again, this is just relatively simple probabilistic, simple but clever probabilistic reasoning on this on the data to figure out whether a given person is in a given beacon or not. And so what we have done after that is to show that actually the attack can be made even more sophisticated and more aggressive by querying first the most rare alleles, so these that are the least frequently encountered, because in that way one gets more quickly to the response of whether, let's say, to the goal of the attacker. Right? I'll spare you the details, but I mean there are just some plots to show how it works. Let me say some word about kin genomic privacy, because this is something that Erman is going to cover as well. Here I'm covering only the problems, and Erman is going to solve everything. So here about kin genomic privacy. And Henrietta Lacks is a lady who lived at the beginning of the 20th century. And she had, so she died in 1951, somewhere she was living in the East Coast. And she had, she was killed essentially by a fatal cancer. So and her cancer, and this was at a time at which there was, the medicine was unable to reproduce human cells. And her cells, the cells of her, essentially extracted from her tumor, were the first that were essentially used and were multiplied and have been used actually all over the world. Right? So they're called the so-called the HeLa cells, Henrietta Lacks. Right? And they've been used for a number of, they've been extremely useful in medicine. Now, there is a wonderful book, The Immortal Life of Henrietta Lacks, that explains the whole story that I can only recommend. It's really as more fascinating than a novel. And it explains the whole process through which the family, her actually offspring, discovered about the whole story, because they were unaware of the fact that the cells of their mother and grandmother were used for medical purposes. And so there was a trial and so on, and finally a kind of agreement was found between the medical authorities of the US and the family to settle the case. But very interesting thing, because they were saying that after all, we are, the cells of our mother and grandmother are used, but actually this is also part of our, you know, genetic inheritance. So we would like to be part of the process. Right? It shouldn't be the case that the cells of our family are used in a way that on which we have no control. So So this is the whole story. So we got inspired by this story, and so we looked at OpenSNP. So OpenSNP is a website where people can upload their own genome. So they go to 23andMe, obtain the file, and then they decide to put their file on OpenSNP, right? And people do this for good motives. Usually it's not let's say, geno-exhibitionism. It's just that they want to use to help medicine in some way. They say, I'm helping science by making my own data available. And they do this either under their real name or under a pseudonym, right? So we found the profile of this fellow, so we removed the name for ethical reasons, but I mean, of course, the names are available. And then it's relatively easy to find the relative of Facebook of this Facebook page of this person. On the Facebook page, one finds the family that this guy happily mentions. And so now it is possible to carry out attacks on, or let's say, to reconstruct probabilistically what the genome of these people can be, right? And maybe these people don't know about nothing, they know nothing about OpenSNP, they don't want to be sequenced, but nevertheless, they information about them gets exposed, right? One can correlate actually those things. And so we've made some various stories, and this was actually presented at CCS 3 years ago in Berlin, 2013, that shows what happens if there is a family, there is a dad, there is a mom, there are kids, and then there's a grandparents. It's somewhat truncated here, but okay. And then what happens if one starts revealing the genome of the relatives and what happens to the level of genome privacy of that specific person? As you know, and unsurprisingly, when you start revealing the people that are related to this person, the genome privacy of this person collapses. Okay. Another example about related kin privacy is a surname inference attacks. So this is based on the fact that it's a very simple reasoning, actually. Well, the idea is that the family name is usually inherited from father to son to grandson, etc. On one side, but in addition to this, the Y chromosome, which is one of the two sexual chromosomes, the Y chromosome is passed almost unchanged from father to son, right? And now by combining the two things, by combining websites that contain genomic data and websites that contain family names, one can actually carry out all kinds of interesting attacks against males, specifically. So there is a paper that describes this whole thing as well. Let me, this is going to be my last but one slide. The topic has become so relevant that Nature, which usually doesn't care too much about cryptography, has published a paper by a journalist whom I met actually at the time. Extreme cryptography paves the way to personalized medicine. So what they mean by extreme cryptography is homomorphic encryption, the way it is phrased, because homomorphic encryption is not really known in the framework of biomed so far, but now they're realizing that they probably need, let's say, techniques of this kind in specific cases. Last slide. So we believe that genome privacy is and security is a grand challenge for mankind because the required duration of protection is beyond one century, because the offspring are involved. The current data size, so it's big, right? It's in the order of half a terabyte per person because of reasons we have seen of the bulk data. And sometimes it is biomed, it is necessary to carry out computations on millions, if not more, of patients' records. So it's big computations. On noisy data, because sequencers still make mistakes, there are correlations within a single genome, this so-called linkage disequilibrium, and there are also correlations across genomes in the same family, as we have seen, but also within the same ethnical group. And we have to cope with a zoo of semi-trusted stakeholders, or the sequencing facilities, the hospital, the genetic analysis labs, the private doctors, the patients themselves, who in some cases will be willing to manage the data by themselves, and so on. And we have seen the diversity of applications and thus of requirements in terms of healthcare, medical research, forensics, and ancestry. Very good. I think I will stop here. Thank you very much for your attention, and I leave the floor to Erman.
All right, thanks. So welcome everyone, thanks for attending again. My name is Erman Ayday, I am from Turkey, from Bilkent University. Actually, we used to work together with Jean-Pierre. And as opposed to what Jean-Pierre said, actually, I'm not going to solve everything, which is also good news, probably for the research community, because I'm going to try to show you that there is still a lot of things to be done in this area. I mean, there are a lot of open points, but the good news is there are a lot of efforts already, and I'm just going to briefly mention you a few of these efforts and how they solve specific parts of the pipeline that Jean-Pierre presented. So that will be the main goal of this part of the talk. And then, of course, the important thing, we are also going to discuss some of the future research directions that many of you may want to, you know, pursue in the future. So some of the key protection strategies that have been considered in order to protect the genomic data so far: existence of trusted parties. Of course, if you have the existence of trusted parties, you still need access control and encryption. The second part is aggregating and obfuscated release of genomic data, for example, using differential privacy, adding some noise on top of the data. There is a huge controversy actually between the medical doctors and the CS researchers, especially on this field. And using semi-trusted parties and hence applying privacy enhancing technologies, namely homomorphic encryption, multi-party computation, functional encryption. So the solutions that we are going to see today are going to be based on these three categories. So before I move to the solution, let me show you a pipeline. So actually this is a figure from a survey that we recently published. So this is the pipeline of genomic data. So as you can see, I mean, you can start looking at from the left to the right. From the very left, there is this human being and the sample from the human, and this sample is being sequenced. Once it is sequenced, and there are many ways of sequencing it, I'm just going to discuss two ways. Then you have to pre-process it. After the pre-processing, you need to store it, then you need to use it in different applications. And the thing is, all these parts, so there's one part, second, third, fourth, and the fifth, all these parts require different attention or different types of techniques to protect the privacy of data. Okay, let me start from the first one. Actually, if you look at the very left, so here I gave the sample goes to the medical doctors or some lab. At that lab, they are doing sequencing or genotyping. The difference between sequencing and genotyping is a process in which you determine the major mutations in your DNA, just like the service 23andMe is providing. Sequencing is a much more detailed process. It's a very, it's a higher cost than genotyping, and it creates a whole genome, whole digital genome of an individual. That's the difference. And in these two parts, actually, when collecting the bio specimen or the sample and while doing the sequencing or genotyping, there is no known technical solution for the security or privacy of genomic data. So that is a very bad news, actually, for us. So in almost all the works that you are going to see in the remaining slides, you will have to assume that these two parts are done at a certified institution or a certified laboratory. I mean, right now there is no technical solution. I mean, solution or some precaution is possible, but these days it is via legislation or policy, not by using some technical solutions. If you ask me, my personal opinion is maybe a trusted hardware may be used in this part, in this process, but this is still an open research question, so you may already start thinking about those types of things. Then, once we receive the output of the sequencer or the genotyping machine, we need to pre-process the data. We need to make some sense out of it, because I'm going to tell you in the next slide, we need some pre-processing or alignment of the generated genomic data. Once we align the data, we need to store it, right? How are we going to store it? So there are some actually interesting characteristics of genomic data, which has a huge lifetime, actually. The lifetime of genomic data is at least as much as the lifetime of a human being, and even more actually if you consider the kinship issues Jean-Pierre just mentioned. That's why we need to have some storage techniques that is resilient to brute force attacks. So I'm going to discuss about that. And then there are many applications you can do by using genomic data: personalized medicine, genomic research, paternity test, using it for you know, recreational purposes. And for these different applications, you need, at some point, you need some different protection techniques to make sure that your genomic data is not leaked, but you still get the service out of it. So this is these parts we are going to discuss one by one. So we can start from the very beginning, actually. And as I told you, for the first and the second part, there is no technical solution, so I'm not going to discuss those parts. So I'm going to start from the pre-processing part. Once I give my sample, I get my digital genome. And that digital genome, at the first place, looks like a big chunk, actually. It's just like, looks like these big chunks. These chunks called, they are reads, actually, and they have to be aligned to your reference genome. So there's a reference genome that is constructed by the scientists. When I receive these short reads, and each short read with today's technology includes about 100 to 400 nucleotides, we have to align them to the reference genome so that we know where they are belong to. So actually, you don't need to think about biologically. You can just think about the computer science problem. You have a very big array, okay, and you have some chunks, subarrays, and you just want to align these subarrays to the very big array. And if you consider the genomic, the size of genomic data, the reference genome has 3 billion nucleotides, and there are hundreds of millions of chunks here, okay? This alignment takes a lot of time. So it makes a lot of sense to delegate this alignment to the cloud, but you cannot directly delegate this alignment to the cloud because genomic data is sensitive. You cannot really provide the genomic data of thousands of individuals to, for example, Amazon Cloud, right? So that's not acceptable. And in order to solve this problem in 2012 at NDSS, Chen and his co-authors proposed a technique, actually, by using a hybrid cloud environment, by using a private cloud and a public cloud at the same time. So doing the most of the work at the public cloud without giving any information about the genomic data and only doing the sensitive work in the private cloud, which is like a local computer. So the idea is, and of course, the alignment is not going to be one-to-one because you cannot, as Jean-Pierre was saying, I mean, more than 99% of the individual, I mean, two individuals share more than 99% of their genomes. They are identical, but there are also some different points, right? So you cannot have a one-to-one alignment between these chunks and the reference genome. Not everyone has exactly the reference genome, so there will be some differences. You have to take account those differences, but the idea is interesting. So it's a simple idea, but it's a very interesting and smart idea, actually. So you have the read, you want to align it to the reference genome, and first of all, you divide the read into D plus one segments, and assuming that you have an edit distance threshold of D. So you don't want to have an alignment match if your edit distance between the read and the reference genome is more than D. And hence, you partition the read into D plus one segments, and then you get the reference genome and create these ELMers. So each of these segments are of length L, and you create these ELMers from the reference genome, and you try to do some matching between these D plus one segments and the ELMers that you created from the reference genome. And you don't do it in plain text. You do a keyed hash mechanism. You hash them by using a key. And then you delegate that matching to the cloud. Because the cloud now cannot see anything. The cloud is just trying to do some matching between the hashes. And once the cloud finds a match, and here is the idea. This is my edit distance threshold, which is D. If I divide my read into D plus one segments, I make sure that at least one of those segments is going to match. If it doesn't match, then I don't have a match after all, right? So this is their idea, which is called seed and extend. The cloud finds the matching point and sends it back to the private cloud. The public cloud finds the matching point, sends it back to the private cloud. Once the private cloud receives the input, then the private cloud can decrypt it, or the private cloud already knows the content, then extends from that matched point. So the bulk of the job is done at the public cloud, and the private cloud just interested in the remaining parts. Once we do this alignment is always required, by the way. You have to do this alignment. That's very important. Once you do the alignment, you need to process this raw genomic data. I mean, especially the raw genomic data, which I told you, the full sequence data, which is composed of all these reads, the size of it is typically around 300 gigabytes per individual, so it's huge, okay? And it is mostly used in for genomic research by pharmaceutical companies. And the main challenge here is you cannot really go and use, you know, traditional public cryptographic systems for a data of size 300 gigabytes. You cannot do really encrypted computing because you increase the size too much. Plus, I mean, doing an encrypted computing on this size of data becomes really inefficient at some point. So in order to do some processing and some storage, secure storage of this data, we previously, a couple of years ago, proposed a technique by using symmetric keying, symmetric stream cipher, which doesn't really increase the size of the data too much. plus using order preserving encryption. But I mean, many of you know order preserving encryption has its own disadvantages. So we used order preserving encryption plus some shuffling technique in order to, you know, reduce that statistical attacks against order preserving encryption. And recently we extended the work. Actually, we also proposed a technique which provides security and privacy for raw genomic data, and on top of it, also provides compression. So this 300 gigabytes is really too much. So we proposed a technique which provides compression and encryption at the same time, which is going to be soon appearing genome research in a biomed journal. So this is the idea actually. On one side, I'm storing this raw genomic data, all chunks of short reads. Okay, and here I'm just trying to show you the goal. And on the other side, the genetic researcher wants to send a query to this data. So the goal is this. Genomic researcher sends this type of a query. I'm just giving an example. So give me all the nucleotides, for example, from chromosome number 21, and from the first nucleotide to the 100th nucleotide. So it gives a range. So this is the requested range. But as you can understand, I mean, in this range, there are many short reads. And this genetic researcher wants to access to all these short reads, okay? And some of these short reads are, you know, between the boundaries. So it has some part within the boundary, it has some part out of the boundary. And some of these short reads, they are within the boundary, but they may be including some sensitive SNPs. Yes?
Is there any information in this short read that is not, it cannot be represented by this VCF file that is from the reference?
No, VCF file is created from the short reads, actually.
So why do you use this raw data instead of just converting it to VCF?
There are a couple of reasons. The first reason is there are still some sequencing errors in today's sequencers, so people want to have access to this raw genomic data. The second thing is especially in the cells, in some cells that has some mutations, for example, in your cancer cells, it is very hard to distinguish between a sequencing error and a mutation. That's why people want to especially the researcher wants to have access to these types of data. That's the main reason. Okay, so that's the goal. I mean, the researcher wants to have this interval, but the researcher doesn't want to leak his access pattern. The researcher doesn't want to say, I really want this interval to the biobank. So the access pattern we are trying to hide. So that's what we are trying to do by using order preserving encryption and this shuffling technique. And there is another thing that we want to mask. As you can see, I mean, this is only the interval that we are supposed to give back to the researcher, and hence we need to mask these parts. So the biobank doesn't know what is requested already, but the biobank has to also mask these parts before giving all this data back to the researcher. And that's why we used actually stream cipher, which is a, you know, XOR mechanism. So you can again just make an XOR in order to mask this data in a very efficient way. So we showed that this is a really efficient way of preserving raw genomic data for in this type of a scenario. Now let's discuss a little bit about the storage. As I told you, storage is interesting for genomic data because it has a very large lifetime, right? So traditional, I mean, all of you know that traditional cryptographic schemes has a lifetime, right? In today's technology, for example, you use RSA, you use some homomorphic encryption, you go and use a key size of 2K or 4K, that will only protect you mathematically, that will only protect you for the next 20, 30 years. It means that if I download some encrypted data, encrypted by RSA, 2K key size, in 20 years, technologically, I will be able to break it or solve the encryption if I keep trying brute force attacks, right? So this may be acceptable for some of the data types. For genomic data, as I told you, the lifetime is at least the lifetime as a human being, and even more when you think about the kinship issues. So for genomic data, this may not be acceptable for some applications. And especially if you consider people are now storing their genomic data on the cloud environments, and when people store the genomic data, they tend to pick weak passwords. So the brute force attack is even more probable in those cases. Therefore, we need to find some, you know, better techniques or more secure techniques that is resilient against brute force attack when if we are trying to protect the security of genomic data. So recently, actually last year, we came up with a technique which is called GenoGuard, and inspired by the recent work by Arigios and Tom Rissenbart, which is called Honey Encryption, which is a new cryptographic primitive, actually. And it provides you an encryption such that you encrypt a message, and even if you decrypt the message by using a wrong cryptographic key, you still get something meaningful. In other words, the attacker cannot understand whether he used the correct key or the wrong key during a brute force attack, which is good, actually, because by doing so, we kind of prevent the brute force attack. So the honey encryption is great, but the problem, not problem, but one of the disadvantages of honey encryption is it only works flawlessly if you have a uniform probability message distribution. And genomic data doesn't have that type of message distribution. Genomic data has correlations within itself. Genomic data has correlations across different genomes. So we had to design this honey encryption technique for a data that is that has non-uniform distribution probability. And I'm not going to go into details here, but I'm just going to show you how it works actually by using a very small toy example. So here is a DNA sequence. If I want to use the GenoGuard or this honey encryption on top of this, before encrypting the data, first I use an encoder to create a seed out of the data. Okay, this is my seed. Then I use just a password-based encryption. So just I encrypt it, I obtain my ciphertext. And if I'm the real user, if I know the correct password, I can just enter the correct password, I get back this seed, and by just using the reverse encoder, or just you can say decoder, I get back my DNA sequence. If I'm the attacker, if I'm trying to, you know, run a brute force attack, so I have a wrong password, I'm trying a wrong password, for example, the wrong password still maps to a seed. It's not the original seed, but it is still a seed, and by using this reverse encoding, the seed still maps to a DNA sequence. And statistically, we proved that you can obtain a valid looking DNA sequence. In other words, what is a valid looking DNA sequence? When you statistically analyze it, you have to make sure that that DNA sequence makes sense. And makes sense means it belongs to a human being. All the correlations within itself make sense. So we try to obtain this type of a property as a result of the decryption of this type of a message. So this is basically how GenoGuard works. All right, so which brings me to the usage of genomic data. And when I say the usage of genomic data, the first thing comes to mind is the clinical usage, probably, because it is very highly used for personalized medicine in order to recommend drugs, especially the dose of some drugs, especially cancer-related drugs. So a couple of years ago, we did a work for the clinical use of genomic data, and the main, and just skipping the wordy description, let me just describe it on this figure. And this setup has been also adapted by many other works later, so you can consider that this is a realistic setup for the clinical use of genomic data. So here we have a patient, okay, and as I told you, unfortunately, for the first part of the pipeline, there is no technical solution. So here we have the same assumption again. The patient sends a sample to a certified institution. Certified institution does the sequencing. After the sequencing, this institution encrypts these SNPs that Jean-Pierre introduced. And the SNPs are stored, encrypted SNPs are stored at a storage and processing unit. You can consider this like a public cloud. So since the SNPs are encrypted, we don't care if the public cloud cannot see the SNPs anyway. So the idea is this: the patient goes to a doctor, the doctor prescribes a particular, for example, disease susceptibility test or some test to understand the dose of a drug that the patient has to use. Then there's a secure two-party computation between the storage and processing unit and the medical center. So we use homomorphic encryption and secure two-party computation actually between these two guys. And as a result of the protocol, we make sure that the doctor only receives the result of the test. The SPU doesn't see anything and doesn't receive anything. And at the same time, neither the SPU nor the patient can also get access to the doctor's, the ingredients of the test, in other words. Because this may not be the doctor, this may be a pharmaceutical company, the test may be a confidential test. So we are also trying to hide that both from the SPU and from the patient. So that's the main idea. So one of the disadvantages of this scheme is, so we are hiding these two things, but we are revealing one thing actually. We are revealing the access patterns of this medical center to this SPU, which may be important for some applications because from the access patterns, the SPU may statistically understand what type of a test is going on. And from that test, maybe SPU may have some understanding about the medical condition of the patient. Okay, that is one of the disadvantage. In order to remove that disadvantage, there was some follow-up work actually by Emiliano De Cristofor and his co-authors. So they generated a scheme, and the scheme hides the position of the tested markers, how many markers are being tested, and the subset of the matched markers. So the things that I was just telling you in the previous slide. So this scheme hides also those information. So in a very brief illustration, here we have the Alice and the Bob, and the Alice is the lab, you can consider. Bob is the patient. Bob has a DNA sequence, so this stream is the DNA sequence of Bob. Alice has these are the indices of the test markers, and this is the length of the test. S represents the length of the test. So they provide their inputs to a black box. It's not a black box, it's an interactive protocol, actually. And then as a result of the protocol, Alice gets the test result, Bob doesn't learn anything, and at the same time, the access patterns of Alice to this genome is also protected. So this is basically how it works in very briefly. So Alice, again, has these indices of the test markers. Bob has its own genome. Bob encrypts the genome by using some partially homomorphic encryption. And this is the main disadvantage of the scheme, maybe. I mean, if you call it a disadvantage, it's just some, there is just some communication overhead. All the encrypted genome is sent to Alice at this point. And from this encrypted genome, Alice cannot see anything, because the encryption is done by using Bob's public key. But Alice can run the test by using the input that she provides. Alice sends the result of the test back to Bob. Bob decrypts it and sends it to Alice. So it's an interactive protocol. It introduces some communication overhead. But at the end of the day, it preserves the access pattern. Okay? If you want to also get rid of that communication overhead, there has been also another follow-up work, actually in 2014 at WPES. This time by Carvelas and his co-authors. This was one of the first examples, actually, by about using oblivious RAM. You all know what oblivious RAM is. It's used to hide access patterns, write and read access patterns, actually, from the cloud. So they implemented oblivious RAM in order to access to genomic data that is stored in the cloud. Okay? I mean, the main problem about oblivious RAM is it becomes really expensive, especially if you want to run it on a big data. So in order to reduce that, in order to make it more efficient, what they proposed is this. The setup still looks like the setup that I introduced you a couple of slides ago. So instead of having a single cloud, they also introduced a new party, which is called the proxy. So all the oblivious RAM operations are done between the cloud and the proxy, though, so they somehow delegated the oblivious RAM operations between two parties and make it more efficient. So this is how the system works. So for example, there is an investigator. You can assume that this is a researcher, and there is this client, which is Alice. So Alice encrypts her genomic data and keeps it at the cloud. And once the investigator wants to do some operation on Alice's DNA, the investigator receives a token from Alice, and Alice also sends a re-encryption key to the cloud. And the cloud does some re-encryption. There's a proxy re-encryption going on here. So the proxy re-encryption makes sure that the data is re-encrypted, and the re-encrypted data is encrypted under the public key of the investigator, so that once the investigator gets the result, he can decrypt the result. So there's this type of proxy re-encryption going on. And then the investigator wants to access some particular part of Alice's genome. Okay? So that part, they use this ORM. And the ORM is run between the cloud and between the cloud and the proxy. And the main operation they are using is they are using Bloom filter, actually, in order to find the positions of the particular SNPs of Alice. And they are, instead of regular hash, they are using a homomorphic hash for the Bloom filter in order to make the shuffling, because shuffling is the most expensive part for the oblivious RAM. In order to make the shuffling more efficient, they are also using a homomorphic hash mechanism. So once the investigator retrieves the SNPs, encrypted SNPs, then there is another final protocol between the investigator and the cloud. It's a garbled circuit protocol, like a two-secure two-party computation. Then the investigator receives the result of the test. But by doing so, they hide access patterns, they hide the genomic data, and they just make sure that only the investigator receives the end result of the test, and the cloud or the proxy doesn't see anything. And yes. For ORM.
Yeah, because how do you use their...
No, for ORM, it's public key encryption.
And they can still re-randomize and do it.
Yeah, they do the re-randomize. I mean, they keep the indices at a Bloom filter. They do the re-random. This shuffling thing is done by using some homomorphic hash for the Bloom filter. Okay? All right, so one of the another popular use of genomic data is genetic paternity test, which brings me to a paper where actually it's a very high impact paper. It appeared in 2011 at CCS, this Gataka paper. And the authors are proposing using private set intersection, PSI, in order to do some genetic tests in a privacy-preserving way. And one of their actually main applications is the paternity test. So the paper discusses personalized medicine and the compatibility test as well. So I'm just going to focus on the paternity test because the methods that are used are very similar, actually. So the paternity test, how do we do the paternity test? If you consider the basic approach, you know, as Jean-Pierre said, about 99.5% of two human genomes are already identical, okay? And obviously the main idea is the parent and the children have even more similar genomes. So we test, we take the parent's genome and we take the alleged child's genome and we try to match them to each other, okay? We look at all these 3 billion positions, we try to match them each other. If the match is more than 99.5%, say 99.5 plus tau, then we say that they are related and that tau determines the level of this relation, okay? So this is the basic approach that you can consider for a paternity test. So, and this is the main structure. So on one side, there is an individual. On the other side, there is a doctor, or this may be another individual, actually, in the case of paternity test. So their inputs is this individual provides his encrypted genome. This doctor or other individual provides his encrypted genome or the, his encrypted test structure or test pattern. And inside this black box, again, there is no black box. It's an interactive protocol. There is some private set intersection protocol going on. And as a result of that, the test result is sent to the individual and to the doctor or the second individual. So that is what is going on, I mean, in overall in the main algorithm. So the thing is, the problem is if you want to use private set intersection and if you really want, need to use these 3 billion symbols in both patients, it takes days. It's not computationally feasible, okay? And the first idea that you may consider is, so I already told you two slides ago, 99.5% of two human genomes are already identical, so why don't we just use this 0.5%, right? The problem is we don't know where it is, actually. So that 0.5%, it exists, but it keeps varying. I mean, it's somewhere among these 3 billion. So we cannot say that I have to go and look at this place in order to find this difference all the time. So it varies between every pair of individuals. So that is the main problem. So you cannot directly go and use that 0.5% difference between two individuals. And in order to overcome this problem, the authors tried an interesting method, actually. They didn't only use cryptography, but they also borrowed the technique from biology, and they used some enzymes, okay? And it's called private RFLP. RFLP means restriction fragment length polymorphism. It's very technical or biological. They used a private RFLP-based paternity test. So here is one individual's genome. This is the second individual's genome. So before digitalizing it, what they did is they applied some enzyme, okay? And the enzyme just divides the genome into some fragments. And these fragments has some definite lengths, okay? And apparently it is enough to compare only these lengths in order to understand if two individuals are related or not. So rather than comparing 3 billion letters, they came up with this idea of comparing only the lengths of some fragments, and based on that comparison, they determine whether they are related or not and how much they are related. And the comparison of these lengths are also done by using private set intersection. All right? So there is this private set intersection cardinality, which compares it, and the length, so my length is not known by the second person lengths are not known by me, so the lengths are remain secret. Okay, we can skip this. And the last part about, in terms of the pipeline is, and also very important part, genomic research. So genomic data is commonly used in genomic research, especially bioinformaticians, and doctors wants to use a lot of genomic data in order to continue their genomic research. And the most widely known name for these types of studies are called GWAS, genome-wide association studies. So there are two goals for this GWAS: analyzing the genomic data to find statistical correlations between SNPs or between the SNPs and some diseases, okay? So this is the first goal, case control study, as Jean-Pierre introduced you at the first half. For example, we have a case group here, they have their genomes. We have a control group, they have their genomes. The only difference between the case and the control is assume that the case group only involves people with Alzheimer's, okay? And the goal of GWAS, for example, in this example, is to find some SNPs which are related to or which are correlated to Alzheimer's, okay? For example, let's look at the third set of SNPs for the case group. So this guy has C, this guy also has C. So let's look at the same index for the control group. This guy has a T, this guy also has a T. So there's a clear distinction between the case and control group for this particular SNP, right? So apparently, as a result of this study, then you can say that this SNP, the third one, is highly correlated with the disease that you are testing. And you can also say the same thing for the seventh one, I guess, which is somewhere over there. Okay, so that's the first goal of GWAS. The second goal of GWAS is to find the correlation between the SNPs in the human DNA, because there are some SNPs, Jean-Pierre was telling you about some linkage disequilibrium. There are some pairwise correlations between SNPs. What I mean is, if you know the value of a particular SNP, you can with a high probability infer the value of another SNP. And these correlations especially are stronger between the closer SNPs in the DNA. And the second objective, thus, of GWAS is to find these correlations. And in order to find these correlations, again, you need huge amount of data and analyze that data. So these are the main two goals. The problem is, again, patient privacy, of course. And there are two problems here, actually. One way to do GWAS is to make all these genomic data publicly available after anonymization. But, I mean, we keep discussing anonymization doesn't make too much sense for genomic data because, you know, the first rule of anonymization is remove the identifier, right? But genomic data is already the identifier, so what can you do? I mean, there is nothing to do. The second thing is do this test, do this GWAS study at a certified institution or at a trusted institution and only reveal the results of the study, okay? But revealing the results of the study is also problematic because of the Homer attack that Jean-Pierre just mentioned. I mean, by just looking at the results, you can easily understand, not easily, but you can statistically understand if a given individual is in a case group or not, and that is really sensitive information, actually. If I understand that a given individual is in a case group which is involved of Alzheimer's patients, so that's not a good information, so I shouldn't be learning that. So these are the two main problems. So there are three lines of research on this topic. The first one is techniques based on differential privacy, especially to protect the second, for the second problem, sharing the test result. The second thing is techniques based on cryptography. Again, homomorphic crypto, secure multi-party computation. And the third one is techniques based on some optimization theorems, okay? Let's start from the first one. I mean, you all know what differential privacy is. I probably don't need to recover it again. And for the time's sake, I'm not going to do it. Actually, I can just skip this part. But it basically means including noise to the result of some queries in order to make it more noisy and hence more private, okay? So how can you use differential privacy in GWAS? For example, there is this researcher here, there is this trusted institution which has the data, doesn't want to share the data, but the institution is okay to share some test results. So these are some sample queries that this researcher may ask. For example, he may ask what's the correlation between these two particular SNPs, or he may ask what are the top 10 SNPs most correlated with some particular disease. So instead of giving the answers of these queries directly, what the institution does is it includes some noise. And the noise depends on the type of differential privacy mechanism that is applied at this institution. And as a result, this guy receives a noisy result. And if he gets a noisy result, he cannot do this membership inference from that result. That's the main idea. All right, so there are two main works on this. One has been published in 2011 by Friedberg and his colleagues. And in this work, the use of the differential privacy, there is a traditional use of differential privacy, actually. So what they use is the Laplace mechanism. So they apply a Laplace noise as a result of the query. One of the main disadvantages of this work is it has been shown that it requires a very large number of research participants in order to guarantee some level of utility. And utility, as you can imagine, is very important in these types of studies. So you should not lose any utility because, I mean, you should really understand which SNP is really correlated with what disease. So that's extremely important. So loss of utility is something unacceptable, especially by the medical community. The second one that is published 2013 by Johnson and Shamatikov, this time they don't use the Laplace mechanism, they use an exponential mechanism of differential privacy. Exponential mechanism makes sure that you get a high quality answer with a higher probability, okay? And hence they applied, they introduced a distance score mechanism, and this scheme shown to provide better utility than the first one, but still it has its own issues still about the utility actually. Overall utility is still not there, it's not still acceptable by many of the medical researchers, but it's a good step. But using differential privacy for genomic data for the release of aggregate statistics is still an open research problem, so you are welcome to have a shot if you have any interesting ideas. There are some cryptographic techniques. I already discussed cryptographic techniques. I'm not going to go into too much details, but the techniques are mostly involving, you know, homomorphic encryption, secure multiparty computation, let's encrypt all the genomes and let's do the data mining on the encrypted genomes. So that's the main idea. There are some techniques by using trusted hardware. For example, there has been a work by Genom and his colleagues in 2012, which uses a trusted hardware, actually. And for example, the idea is there are multiple hospitals. Hospitals doesn't like to share their data directly. Instead of sharing it directly, there is another institution. And at this institution, there happens to be a secure coprocessor. So the hospitals encrypt the data by using some symmetric keys. They send the encrypted data to this institution. And they also encrypt their symmetric keys with the public key of this secure coprocessor and send those to this secure coprocessor. And you get the idea. All the important, all the sensitive operations are only done inside this secure coprocessor. Nothing is leaked outside of it. And hence, the hospitals can easily share their data, knowing that the data will never leave the secure coprocessor. So that's the main idea. And the last line of research is using some optimization techniques. This is some work that we did a couple of years ago. And this is based on optimization. And the optimization problem is like this. So for example, individuals have some privacy budgets. And you know that the genomic data is correlated between family members. And me and my family members has some privacy budgets. I don't want to exceed that budget. At the same time, I want to share my genomic data as much as I can because I want to be, you know, beneficial for genomic research. So there's an optimization problem. I want to maximize the utility. At the same time, I want to make sure that those privacy budgets are still preserved. So that's why we formulated the problem as an optimization problem, and we tried to see how much utility we can get by still in plain text revealing our genomic data. So this is the last line of research. And I also want to acknowledge some of the work that is related to comparing genomes. So comparing genomes is still important because, you know, by comparing genomes, you can do paternity tests, you can do some other applications. Similar patients are also important. So there are some research on it. Transoco Pastoria, his colleagues, used a finite state machine, for example, to do the comparison. And this is one of the first works on the field. And this is the Gataka paper, Baldi and his colleagues in 2011. They used private set intersection, I already mentioned. A couple of years ago, we proposed using functional encryption, actually an efficient implementation of functional encryption in order to compare the genomes by using garbled circuits. And there is a recent work from CCS 2015, Wang and his colleagues, about private edit distance in order to find similar patients that are distributed in different hospitals in a country, which is a very interesting work. Okay, so we don't have too much left, but I also want to discuss a few of the open research problems, though they are not all of it, but they are also interesting. So we, as I told you, I mean, the main idea of today is to motivate you to work on these problems, actually, not telling you that we thought about the problem and we solved everything. So we didn't. I mean, nobody did, actually. So these are still some of the open research problems. They are really important, at least according to us. So let me just go through them very fast. So genomic data sharing between different entities, for example, between hospitals, even between countries, still very important because the scale of the data is very huge. So it's very important to find scalable, efficient algorithms for this sharing. Privacy versus utility, still very important research question, especially if you use differential privacy. You provide privacy, but at the same time, how can you maximize the utility of the data? So integrating genomic data into the EHRs, electronic health records, still didn't happen yet, but it's going to happen very soon, actually. But we need to find out some techniques in order to integrate those two digital information together. There are access control issues, especially for genomic data. The genomic data is interesting because as you, for example, you are the doctor, you have access to your patient's genomic data over and over again, and from those accesses, you can actually create a genomic profile of your patient very easily. So you have to have some privacy budget. You have to consider different techniques, some dynamic access control techniques when accessing genomic data. There are these credibility and liability issues that we have been recently started working, actually. For example, liability means, so I'm sharing my genomic data with 10 different institutions, and at some day, for example, 1 month after this day, I figure out that my genomic data is on the internet. So who should I blame? Okay, I lost my genomic privacy, but at least maybe I need to address these liability issues. So which one of these institutions is responsible for that data leak? So it can be considered for all type of data, actually, but we are working on genomic data part of it. And interoperability, I mean, this is really important to me. So all the solutions, I mean, I showed you a lot of solutions, right? Not too much, but I showed you more than 10 solutions over the last 30 minutes. So the main problem about all these solutions is it's great. They solve a specific problem. They solve a specific part of the pipeline, but they don't work together. Okay, and if you have a solution, if you want to have a global solution on genomic data, you want to have something that covers the whole pipeline. I mean, you don't want to decrypt the data, re-encrypt it again for some other solution and keep doing it, so on. So interoperability between all these solutions, it's an open research problem. It's very important open research problem. Plus this standardization efforts. I mean, there's already some standardization efforts by GA for GH. Doing these types of, continuing these types of efforts are really extremely important. There are some EU e-health initiatives already. For example, the notable ones, EPSOS for sharing health data between entities, Stork managing identities, again, between cross-border identities or identities of the individual when the individual is mobile. So these initiatives currently don't consider genomic data too much, but it is very important that the solution that are going to be proposed are going to be compliant with all these initiatives. That's very important because they are already there. It's not very hard to, you know, integrate your solutions into these. And there are also efforts in the US. Of course, there is this Tau NSF-funded project, and its main goal is innovating mobile and cloud computing systems with respect to privacy of individuals, especially considering medical data. And genomic data is a part of this project, actually. It's a very important US-based project. There are some efforts already. So there has been some conferences, some workshops. For example, 2 years ago, there was this Genopri International Workshop on Genome Security and Privacy. It was co-located with PETS. Last year, it was co-located with IEEE SMP Auckland. This year, actually, it's in 2 weeks, and it's going to be in Chicago. So you are more than welcome to join if you have more interest on this topic. And there is this IDESH competition. And this year, actually, it is also going to be in Chicago in 2 weeks. So they are going to be next to each other with Genopri. So it's going to be an interesting 2 days if you have any interest to this topic. We did a couple of Dachstuhl gatherings in order to, you know, brainstorm on this thing, and it might probably keep going on. There is a web page. It's a community web page devoted only to this topic, actually. And if you are curious, it includes almost all the papers that exist on this field. It has some tutorials. If you are new to biology, if you want to learn a little bit about the background, there is a lot of material here, and you can also keep track of the upcoming events in terms of the topic. There is also a book recently published. It's a medical data privacy book. It's kind of a long book, as you can see, but at least three chapters are completely devoted to genomic privacy. So it may be a good first step if you want to, you know, get more involved in the field. And just one last advertisement. There's a special issue of IEEE Security and Privacy magazine. I know the deadline is little bit, at least the abstract deadline is little bit soon, in 2 weeks, not in 1 week, actually. But the main submission, I mean, you still have 2 more months after you submit the abstract. You still have 2 more months to submit the full paper. And this is going to be an interesting venue as well. So just some acknowledgments for some colleagues that we have been working together over the last three, four years. And just to conclude, I hope we could, you know, convince you that medicine is really getting massively digitalized, especially from the first part of this tutorial. And some examples are genomic sequencing, of course, EHRs, telemonitoring, emergence of this P4 medicine, precision, personalized, predictive, and participatory medicine. And because of this digitalization, the security and especially the privacy of medical data is really in a big danger because of this digitalization. And hence, I mean, the thing that we have to do is, and this is some battle that, honestly, I mean, humankind cannot lose, both as individuals and as researchers. Because, I mean, we are right now doing, we are at CCS, we are doing very similar, and we are generating actually some solutions exactly to solve this problem, right? We are both security privacy researchers, so the type of research that we are doing is really addressing this battle. So we can really win this battle as a result of this research, but in order to do that, we need this. We need to fully understand the complex requirements of the medicine. We need to really work in collaboration with biomedical community, which is kind of not too easy, but it is doable. We have to work with the biomedical community, and we need to invent software and hardware tools in order to win this battle. Okay, thank you very much.
Yes. Very brief question.
Yeah.
When was this field started? Which is the first really important paper on this topic?
I think it's the Homer's paper. It was 2008.
But you mean genome privacy in general, genome security?
Security and privacy of genome, yeah.
Yeah, I would say Homer paper is probably showing the kind of attack. So if you could put back the website. genomeprivacy.org, exactly. This here. If I go
to you may want to
search,
close to the mic.
I'm sorry. There are search possibility. You can search the database of all the paper, roughly 150 papers already on the topic. So it's still manageable. It's manageable, I'd say. Yeah.
Plus, I mean, the problem is, I mean, people don't really get interested until there is an attack, right? So that was the first attack. So after that attack, people immediately started getting interested about the field.
More questions?
Thank you.
Actually, this is recorded, so you may want to make use of the mic.
Yeah.
If you mind. And actually.
So thank you. I mean, this was an excellent tutorial, really. And one question I would like to put is that, you know, in the solution, so Erman, you focus mainly, with a couple of exceptions, on data-oriented solutions, you know, things that are, you know, algorithms, abstract, they can run anywhere. And I haven't talked much about, you know, the other part, you know, the distributed system solutions, you know, clever architectures combining NGS machines, early filtering, you know, segregated clouds, you know, hybrid storage, this middleware. Is it because it's not so important, or for any other reason?
To me? I mean, it is important.
You are the guy with the solutions.
Yeah, sure, no problem. Exactly. I mean, the very first solution, the one about the alignment, is a distributed cloud solution, actually. And I think those types of solutions are extremely important, but there are not many, actually. So I only showed you the existing solution. So that may be a solution to a, you know, one of these open research problems, and it would be great, actually.
Luke Desitales, North Carolina State University. You guys made the argument that it's not efficient or scalable, or that it's too expensive for governments and attackers to keep collecting raw data. However, you also showed a slide showing an extremely steep decline in the cost of doing these genomic sequences. Is there a reason to believe that the cost of genomic sequencing has stabilized? Does it require a rare metal, or is I see a future where I go into Walgreens and I spit on a tube and then it instantly gives me my sequence.
Right. So now it is true indeed that the cost is going to keep declining. At the same time, it should be, I mean, nowadays it is still a relatively difficult operation. Right? So it requires very costly machinery. So the machinery in the order of hundreds of thousands of dollars. It requires qualified personnel and so on. So if you have seen the movie Gattaca, it gives the impression that you just go there, you provide a hair, and boom, you get the genome. So we are not there yet, right? And it's just not clear that we will ever reach that level of, let's say, ease of sequencing. So there will always be this kind of barrier, but this barrier is, as you pointed out, is declining. As a consequence, the risk is increasing. That was also the reason for us to start working in this field, and also the reason to setting up this the tutorial to, let's say, raise the awareness of the community. So it is exactly this kind of reasoning that pushes us to say, well, look, there is an issue here. It has to be properly addressed, and one cannot rely exclusively on the legislation for this to be fixed. So thanks you for raising the issue.
Just one addition, but again, I mean, we only showed the technical solutions, right? I mean, I honestly don't think that the technical solution is going to be the solution of the overall problem. Of course, legislation and the policy should be there. And I already know some existing efforts about that type of things. For example, you go to Walgreens and they provide you a genetic test. So people try to use at least some secure hardware inside that test so that your genomic data cannot be obtained. You only get the test results. So these types of technical solutions are trying to be implemented on those devices. So hopefully it's not going to be allowed at any time.
Right.
Thank you for the great presentation. My name is Thomas Sander from Hewlett-Packard Labs. I have a question. You've shown us the different solutions. Do you have a sense from looking at, you know, the technical realities, the business realities, the regulatory realities, which of these technologies would you venture, or which of these ideas are we going to see first deployed for real? Which ones do you give the best chances of becoming deployed in the real world?
You mean in terms of legislation with respect to technical solutions and the like? So. Because there is already legislation. There is legislation nowadays, both in Europe and in the US, and even in Switzerland, to say, okay, for example, genomic data cannot be used, should not be used for example, recruitment purposes, with a few exceptions. But as an employer is not supposed to ask a candidate for their genomic profile. This is forbidden by law.
Right? No, I understand that. What I meant is, given all these realities, which of these technologies do you see as the most promising to make it into the, you know, to make it into the real world soon?
Or among the technologies themselves. So I would say there are essentially two things. So one is that there's going to be progress on the front of, let's say, the statistical aspects. So, for example, differential privacy, which dialect of differential privacy would be used in order to let researchers access the data and yet protect the data in some way. So this would be the case of legitimate access, right? Now, whether differential privacy is really going to be used in this field or not is still unclear. This is still a matter of debate. But it is on the statistical front, there are a lot of people working to see what is the best solution. And then on the access control, so to prevent illegitimate access. So this is also another area. And here it could well be, for example, that homomorphic encryption might be a solution that after all makes sense, because the stakes are so high that it does make sense to have, let's say, that level of investment to protect the data. So we deal at EPFL on a very regular basis with hospitals, but also with politicians, with the lawmakers on this topic. So we are not just working on the technological aspects, but we are also, dealing and working and collaborating and talking with the people of the other fields that are also very important, including the geneticists themselves, of course. And there is a tremendous concern that we are observing about all this whole story, and including at the political level. I happen to interact from time to time with the health minister of the canton in which Lausanne is located, and the canton of Vaud. And it is a real concern for the authorities, because what the nightmare scenario would be that through the medical system, all this data gets sifted and then gets misused. Right? Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Yep. Sure.
I'm actually a bioinformatician and spent the last 4 or 5 years working with next generation sequencing data. And I can tell you really scary stories about what researchers do not care about in terms of security and privacy and so on. And I guess I just wanted to make the comment that there is a lot to do, and there are not very many people caring about security. So if you're interested, please start working on it.
Well, thanks for this encouragement. There is actually a small but growing community that is working on this. As Erman pointed out, there are workshops happening. So it's still relatively small, more or less the size of the number of people in this room. Yeah. But it is happening, it's coming in gently. What you're telling us about about the status of affairs on the front of biomed research is not surprising to me, in the sense that when we talk with some of the biomed researchers, so those who are not involved in healthcare, but just on research, their priority is let the data speak, and they are not particularly keen to have the data be protected, because they tell us, well, anyhow, the predictability value of genomic data is relatively modest, and it's going to save lives if we can go fast, and so on. Mm-hmm. But as soon as we talk with hospitals and with the healthcare system, et cetera, or the politicians, it's a completely different mindset. Mm-hmm. So the two things currently coexist.
And I mean, in my experience as well, I honestly received data from bioinformaticians. I'm right now in Turkey through Dropbox or Google Drive. So that happens right now. Even though I don't appreciate it, I have to do my simulations as soon as possible. So yeah, that's how they send it.
One very common practice I observed was that researchers often use web-based genome browsers, like the UCSC genome browser, mm-hmm. and you can host your own genomes on your own HTTP server, and the genetic data is just transferred over regular HTTP to the US over I don't know how many parties, and this is really scary.
Thank you.
Okay, I think we are 15 minutes behind schedule. So thanks a lot for keeping with us. And okay, let's
thank you. Thank you very much.